هيا على الفلاح.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أما بعد, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers and sisters, welcome to the Ta'weez Project. Alhamdulillah, today we have Ustad Abdurrahman Hassan with us. We've been getting a lot of questions online on the Facebook page and through our email from a lot of you guys out there wanting to know more about the issues of Ta'weez. And basically we want to try and clarify some of the doubt with regards to the issues that you guys have been raising and sort of help understand the questions. So Ustad Abdurrahman is going to try and help us with that today, inshallah. Before we get started, inshallah, can you first and foremost sort of define what a ta'weez is for the people that don't know, inshallah?
Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Lahul Hamdul Hassan, Wa Thana'ul Jameel, Wa Ashadu An La Ilaha Illallah Wahdahu La Sharika Lah, Yaqulu Al-Haqqa Wa Huwa Yahdi Sabeel. وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد, first of all, جزاك الله خيرا for having me and for having good thoughts about me, inshallah ta'ala. And I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gives you guys tawfiq in the project that you're doing, inshallah ta'ala, which is a good cause. بارك الله فيكم, purifying the people from this shirk concept,
definitely,
and etc. جزاكم الله خيرا. The first question that you asked me was
sort of if we can sort of set the groundwork, set the foundations of what a ta'weez is, what it entails, what is and what isn't a ta'weez. You know, has it got any other names or that people might know it by, and etc.
The ta'weez is that which somebody wears. It can either be a, some people they wear rocks, some wear they bones, some might even just be a string. Differs from person to person, it may be different things. But if a person wears it, or it's worn to lidafi' al-ayn, to get rid of an evil eye.
Okay, like a protection.
A protection, okay. Na'am. If the person believes that this thing which they are wearing right now is actually protecting them, then this becomes shirk akbar. It's a major shirk. Okay. If they actually believe that this ta'weez or this tamimah,
yeah,
and the plural is tamaim, in which they are wearing, if they believe that this can actually remove the evil eye or get rid of the evil eye or protect them, then this is shirk akbar.
Okay.
But if the person believes that this is a means, it's a wasila, I don't believe this can remove or protect me, but I believe it's a means of protection, then this is minor shirk.
Like a medicine.
Medicine.
Okay.
But medicine, the means is actually proven.
Okay.
By tajruba, experiment. But the tamima, by the religion, we've realized that it doesn't do anything. It doesn't help you. It's not proven to be a means.
Okay. And so, if somebody says, you know, I wear this thing for helping me in my business, for good fortune, to increase me in my wealth, or, for example, a husband and wife, you know, who've been suffering problems and they've been arguing a lot. So, they go to see somebody and they you know, they get given this ta'weez, or I mean, has it got any other names?
Na'am. In Arabic it's called ta'weez. Somalis they call it hirsi.
Okay.
The Arabs they call it tamaim.
Tamaim.
And in the
yeah,
Asian they call it ta'weez.
Okay.
The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, where he said inna ruqa wa tamaim wa tiwala shirkun. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said these three are shirk. The tamima, that the person wears, the ruqa, which is the ruqya, which is that consists of shirk in it, and the tiwala, which is that the spell that the woman asks for her to be placed on her husband so he can have love for her, or that which she herself is placed on so her husband can love her, or the vice versa. This is called tiwala. All of them are shirk. So it can either be major shirk, which is if that person is actually wearing it for their business, they are wearing the tamima, so they can get their business flowing and they believe that this can do it. Then this becomes shirk akbar. They leave the religion because of it. And if they believe that no, Allah is the one who makes my business flow, but I'm only wearing this as a means, then in this situation it becomes a minor shirk and Allah knows best.
So just to clarify that point before we move on, inshallah, potentially somebody wearing this, would it mean that that person would have to retake their shahada or re-establish their Islam? Is it something that bad that it can make a person a kafir or not a Muslim anymore?
No, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he himself is saying that it is shirk. Mm-hmm. And anything that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam referred to it as a shirk, then you can see the danger and the seriousness of it.
Yeah.
So one has to abstain and be as far as possible as they can. And walidhalika, that's what we would also need to remember, the hadith which Imam al-Bayhaqi rahimahullah, he narrated in his Shu'ab al-Iman, and also the hadith itself is in Sahih al-Bukhari, in hadith Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمْ يَجْعَلْ شِفَاءَكُمْ, Allah did not make your cure in what? فِيمَا حَرَّمَ عَلَيْكُمْ, that which he has made haram from you.
Okay.
So anything which Allah has made haram, there is no cure in it for us. Our cure, we can find it in the halal things. So trying to find a cure, whether it's for your business, whether it's for your career, whether it's for your children, whether it's even for yourself and your health, trying to look for it in that which Allah has prohibited is actually only going to increase your illness.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the hadith in which the noble companion, Imran ibn Husayn, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he had it in his arm. He was wearing a string on his arm.
Okay.
So he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Prophet then said to him, وَيْحَكَ مَا هَذِهِ, woe be to you, what is this that you're wearing? Why are you wearing this? What's the cause to it? And then he said, Ya Rasulullah, I'm wearing it from the wahina, which is a form of illness.
Okay.
It's to protect me from this illness. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, إِنَّهَا لَا تَزِيدُكَ إِلَّا وَهْنًا, this thing that you're wearing, it does not increase you except in weakness. You're going to only become weak from wearing it. And then the Prophet added on saying to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, لَوْ مِتَّ, if you died, Imran, if you died, وَهِيَ عَلَيْكَ, and this thing you're wearing was on you, مَا أَفْلَحْتَ أَبَدًا, you will never have found success and prosperity. Ahmed narrated that in his Muslim. So the person who's wearing it needs to realize that whatever you're looking for, you're not going to gain it whilst you have this thing on you. Get rid of it. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he ordered him to destroy it and to get rid of it.
SubhanAllah.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.
So from anywhere from the sunnah, you're saying that there's nowhere from the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam where he advised us to wear these kind of things or spoke about them, except in telling people to destroy them and get rid of them and speaking about them as being shirk.
Alayhi salatu wa sallam. And that's not only what he said, salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi, because our understanding in the religion is also taken, or the way we practice our religion is we base our, what the Prophet says or what he does, on how the companions understood it.
Mm-hmm.
It's very important, it's very vital that we look at that.
Nah.
So the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they understood the danger and the seriousness of it as well. Because when they saw that how, in different situations, him prohibiting it, speaking against it, rebuking it, scolding those who were wearing it, they realized how dangerous it was.
Mm-hmm.
And here you see Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He came into the house, and now dakhala ala imra'ati, he came into the house and he saw his own wife. And وَفِي عُنُوقِهَا, on her neck, she was wearing it.
Mm-hmm.
And then he, فَجَبَذَهُ وَقَطَعَهُ, he took it off her neck and he ripped it off.
SubhanAllah.
Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. Wow. Radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then he said to her, did the family of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, after Allah gave them something and they made them rich and Allah gave them rizq, are they going to wear this?
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to associate partners with Allah? Rather, he said, are they going to associate partners with Allah? And yushriku billahi ma lam yunazzil bihi sultana.
SubhanAllah.
So the Sahabas also understood that this act of wearing the tamima and the tama'im is shirk, or the ta'weez is shirk billahi al-aliyyul azim.
Lakin Ustad, some people, they say, obviously we've had many messages about these issues, and some of the viewers will be able to relate to this, that some people say that if the thing that they're wearing, you know, it only contains the Quran or the Kalam of Allah, or maybe, you know, the names and attributes of Allah inside of it.
Sahih.
And, you know, they say that their Imam or their Mufti or their Mawlana has given this and advised them to wear this for the things that we've mentioned, for wealth and good fortune and etc. That there's permissibility in this from the Sharia. And they also claim that, you know, there are evidences from some of the companions where they would wear this. I mean, is there anything
good? Now, in this issue of the tamima, in which they wear the tama'im min al-Qur'an, the tamima or the ta'weez,
yes,
wearing it and it has the Qur'an on it or has the words of Allah in it or etc.
Mm-hmm.
What's the ruling pertaining to this? Now, the Sahaba of the companion, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam amongst themselves, and the people of knowledge, generally speaking, قد اختلفوا في جوازي تعليقها. They differed on it. Is it permissible or is it not permissible? There's difference of opinion. Some said it's impermissible, and others they said it is permissible. Now we have to now realize, if there's a khilaf, there's a difference of opinion. What did the Quran instruct us to do? Allah says in the Quran, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ, if you differ upon a matter and you have difference of opinion, فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ, bring it back to Allah and His Messenger. إِن كُنتُمْ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. So every difference of opinion, every argumentations that we find, we always have to bring this issue back to the Kitab and the Sunnah, and the answers would be there, inshallah ta'ala. The Quran or the Sunnah, when we look at it, we find that the argument or the side that says that it's impermissible to use the tamima that has Quran in it is stronger.
Okay.
And this is not this is the view held by Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. It is also this view held by Abdullah ibn Abbas. Hudhayfah ibn al-Yaman held that view. Uqbah ibn Amr held that view as well. Imran ibn Husayn also held that view. Okay. And other companions, they all held the view that is haram.
Okay.
And they are stronger without a doubt.
Yeah.
So why are they stronger? And how are they stronger? Three reasons, I'll summarize it, why they're stronger. Number one is the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he did not distinguish between the tamima that has Quran in it and the one that doesn't have Quran. The Prophet didn't.
General.
Whenever he prohibited, it was always general.
Okay.
And he said, "Inna ruqa wa tamaim wa tiwala tamaim." General, unrestricted. When the Prophet prohibited it from Imran ibn Husayn, he didn't say, "Imran, you're wearing something on your arm. What is it that you're wearing? Let me see. Is it Quran on it?" He didn't ask him.
Yeah.
And the scholars, they say, "Ta'khir al bayan fi waqt al haja." The Prophet to clarify a matter at a time when it's needed, is obligatory on him. So if it was if this issue right now, it needed distinguishing, the Prophet would have been the one that who does what? He would have clarified it, alayhi salatu wasalam. He would have said, look, it's not all haram, there are this and that. He would have clarified it. The fact that he did not clarify it like that, and he left it unrestricted, we have to leave it unrestricted. That's number one. So no companion could come and specify what the Prophet unrestricted. Number two is, we have to close the door that's going to lead to shirk. And what you tend to find is that these tamaim that people wear, a lot of them are being fooled and tricked to think that what they're wearing, it has Quran in it. And so the Sharia has a concept which is saddu dhara'i. The doors that lead to something are closed.
That's true, actually, because that's a lot of the time that's what we find. That people will contact us and they'll say, we've been given this thing, but it's just got Quran, you know? Like when they actually open it and they look for themselves, and mashallah, alhamdulillah, you know, more and more people now, they're taking the ta'weeth challenge. They're making the effort, and they are getting the courage. They're gaining the courage. They're seeing more and more people do it, and they're more inclined to open it themselves. And alhamdulillah, there's videos out there. Some of the links will be below on how to, you know, destroy a ta'weeth. Like this is what we're finding. Someone said, I've been told that it's Quran, but when they open it, they find that it's not the Quran.
Exactly.
You know?
So, and the thing that we also have to realize is that the Sharia has a concept which is al-hakamu lil-aghlabiyya. The ruling is, it revolves around the majority. It doesn't revolve around nadir, things that are rare that happen. The majority of the people are wearing shirk. And we fewly find a few people who are wearing Quran, maybe. But the majority, the overwhelming majority, are wearing shirk on it. And numbers and boxes and codes and stuff that we don't understand. So the second reason, as I mentioned, was saddu dhara'i. The third point, sorry, is the people who are wearing it, they go into places which are filthy, like toilets. The thing that is in it a lot of times is left dirty. If there is even Quran written on it, it's left dirty, it's not cleaned, it's not well looked after. And then it leads to the verses of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to be put in the filthy, dirty places.
Belittling it.
And the Quran of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is one that we were told and we were ordered to honor the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those three main reasons alone show the opinion of the scholars who held that it is impermissible to even have Quran written on it are stronger, and Allah knows best.
Barakallahu feek, Ustad. So one of the other questions we get is a lot of people, they find, because you mentioned it earlier, boxes. The Quran being translated into, I think it's abjad numbers or some kind of number system where people don't actually write the Quran, they write numbers instead. And essentially, we're asking, is this permissible? Does this have a basis within the religion? Does this have a basis within the Sharia? And you know, if you could elaborate on that, inshallah.
Again, no. This is, has no basis. The fact that the Quran is then converted into digits and numbers, this is the kutab of the kuhan, the fortune tellers, the magicians. This is what they write. That's their speech. And it's codes that they use for the shayateen. A Muslim now who believes that, that this is the Quran, where does it say in the Quran that the Quran, so Basmala is, or the Quran
786
for instance, like this, where does that, where basis has that got in the Sunnah? Did the Sahabas ever understand it like that? Do we ever find it in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That to be added on, the scholars who said that, even the scholars who said that it's permissible, it's permissible to use the Quran as a tamima, they said it has to be clear that's the Quran.
Okay.
It has to be clearly written.
Okay. I mean,
it's not even just that the Quran, they book conditions down. That it's an ayah from the Quran, it's clearly written, it can be seen, everyone can read it. So it's not, even if it's written, but it's written in a scribbled manner, hatta is not permissible according to the ones who say.
So what if it's written, but it's written, and then a lot of the time we find they wrap it, and they fold and fold and fold and fold into a very small little sort of a thing, and then they wrap it with plastic and tie it and then put it into the leather pouches.
Okay.
This is
but when you open it all up and you look at it, do you find the Quran written clearly? Can your eyes see it properly?
95% of the time, from you know, I would say hundreds of cases that have been sent to us, 99% there's no Quran. You know, very few, a few percent will find the actual Quran is there. But even when it's written, it's like you say,
scribbled.
It's scribbled. It's not clearly written like you find in the Mushaf, like Neaton.
No, the scholars, they say it has to be clear, it has to be seen, it has to be known that it's a verse from the Quran.
Okay.
So with those conditions stipulated, put there, then and only then, those who say it's permissible, then they argue it's permissible on those bases.
Okay.
But then none of them has ever said, on those who said it, that it's permissible for you to use the Quran, none of the scholars, from the Sahabas, wala tabi'in, said you can put it in codes or numbers. Subhanallah.
Jazakallah khair. So finally, Ustad, I think to wrap it up, obviously you've given us some good evidences in terms of the ta'weez and what it is, and you know what the Sharia perspective on it is. Like, let's say for example, for the people at home watching this video, I'm thinking of taking a ta'weez off. You know, I've been wearing it, somebody gave it to me, and I used to suffer from headaches, for example, or I'm a husband, or you know, there's a wife who's found it's brought peace within the household, and I've seen all the evidence, and I want to take it off. But what, where does that leave me? You know, I've had this thing, and it's done great for me. So what can I do? You know, in terms of guidance from Allah Subhanahu wa Taala and the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what do I do next? You know, what should? How can I protect myself?
Naam, this concept of getting rid of it and destroying it is the first step that the person needs to take. Once now that you found out the ruling, and you know what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has commanded you, and that which He has told you, or the Prophet has said to you, a believer has no other choice except to submit. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. If Allah and His Messenger command a matter, you have no other choice except to submit. You have to follow and adhere. In this situation, you have to follow that which Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has said, and the Prophet in this issue. And that, what is it that Allah and His Messenger have commanded here? Is that you get rid of it. The Prophet told Imran ibn Hussein, throw it and destroy it.
Yeah.
So our brothers, jazakumullahu khairan, may Allah bless you. You've put a process where the people who are wanting to take it off, a process, and inshallah ta'ala, which you will explain to them later, in which they need to take in order to get rid of it.
Yes.
The person has to straight away get rid of it.
Yes.
The Prophet didn't say to Imran, think about it, pray istikhara on it, you know what, discuss it. He didn't say that.
Yeah.
He said, throw it, get rid of it. The same. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud didn't ask his wife, why. He didn't talk to her. He just ripped it off.
Got it off. Yeah.
So to get rid of it.
Yeah.
So if your family members are wearing it and you have power over them,
mm-hmm.
like you have power over your children and what, rip it off. Okay. Rip it off and get it. If you're a doctor mm-hmm. and patients are coming to you mm-hmm. and they're wearing this and you have power, inshallah, and there's not a harm coming to you from it, then mm-hmm. cut it off.
Mm-hmm. You see? But what do we give the people?
Now the alternative that the Sharia has placed. Yeah. A lot of these people that you see doing this, they don't even read Ayatul Kursi. Mm-hmm. Which is أعظم آية في كتاب الله. It's the greatest verse in the Quran.
Yeah.
When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told the Sahabi al-Jaleel, mm-hmm. Ka'ab ibn Malik, when he told Ubay ibn Ka'ab, Abu al-Mundhir, he said, لِيَهْنِكَ الْعِلْمَ يَا أَبَا مُنذِرْ. Do you know أَيُّ آيَةٍ أَعْظَمُ فِي كِتَابِ اللَّهِ? Do you know the greatest verses in the Quran? The great ayat. They don't even read Ayatul Kursi when they go to sleep. They don't even read the Mu'awwidhatayn. When the Prophet got sick from the magic that was placed on him, yeah. What did he do? Did Allah tell him to take ta'weez and tama'im? Mm-hmm. Or did Allah tabarak wa ta'ala command the Prophet to recite the Mu'awwidhatayn? قُلْ عَذْرُ النَّاسِ أَنْ قُلْ عَذْرُ الْفَلَقِ. He was commanded to recite. Yeah. They don't read those. Mm-hmm. The dua that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the hadith Abu Dawood and Tirmidhi and Ahmad in his Muslim narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِذَا فَرَغَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي النَّوْمِ فَلْيَقُلْ. One of you finishes his sleep and he's over with his sleep, he should say, أَعُوذُ بِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ تَمَاتِ مِنْ غَضَبِي وَعِقَابِي وَشَرِّ عِبَادِي وَمِنْ هَمَزَاتِ الشَّيَاطِينِ وَأَنْ يَحْضُرُونَ فَإِنَّهُ لَا تَضُرُّهُ. The person makes these adhkar.
Yes.
You have the small little book, Fortress of Muslim, written by Sa'id ibn Wahf al-Qahtani. Mm-hmm. Looking at that book alone, you get all the du'as that you need to do daily. لذلك mm-hmm. the hadith that book was named after, the Fortress of a Muslim, that book is hadith in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that the one who makes his du'a is like a person who ran from an enemy and he got into a fortress.
Fortress.
And the fortress is to protect you. The mm-hmm. adhkar is like that. The one who makes his adhkar, he's one who's going to be what? Who went into this fortress and he's away from his enemy.
It's like a guard.
Na'am. Yeah. And the Prophet would do that for his grandsons, Hassan and Hussein, when mm-hmm. they would come, he would say, أعوذ بكلمات الله تامات. He would make this for them.
Yeah.
Never did he say, wear tamaim, and wear this and wear that. Yeah. So our guidance is, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُصْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. The Prophet in him is a great example and a great role model. Reading these as adhkar, and reading these things is what he's commanded his companions. Blowing it onto your hands and then wiping it over your whole body. Reading Quran on yourself. Mm-hmm. These are, inshallah ta'ala, the ways to cure yourself and to gain the good that you're looking for.
Inshallah. And placing your trust in.
Without a shadow of a doubt. That your heart is connected to who?
No.
To Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And that you also believe with unwavering conviction.
Yes.
The hadith of Abdullah ibn Abbas, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, احفظ الله يحفظك. احفظ الله تجده تجاهك إذا سألت فاسأل الله وإذا استعنت فاستعن بالله وعلم أن الأمة لو اجتمعوا على أن ينفعوك بشيء لم ينفعوك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله لك وإن اجتمعوا على أن يضروك بشيء لم يضروك إلا بشيء قد كتبه الله لك رفعت الأقلام وجفت الصحف. That you need to first of all, before this problem occur to you, before this sickness occur to you, before this bankruptcy occur to you, or before it happens, remember and safeguard Allah's boundaries and His religion. Follow the orders that you were given. Stay away from that which you were told to stay away from. So the time when the illness befalls you, you lift your hands up, Allah is here to listen to you and obey your calling.
Yeah.
Eat halal and make sure your rizq and that which you're eating is halal. Don't eat haram and then lift your hands up with haram flesh or haram hands.
Yeah.
So all these are things that we need to take into consideration. All of these things are things that we need to follow. And we also need to believe that no one can benefit us except if Allah has written it for us. Mm-hmm. And no one can harm us except if Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has written it for us. And our trust and our belief and i'timad, reliance is on Allah tabarak wa ta'ala alone. Anything which I have said that is incorrect is from me and shaytan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik, ashadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka atubu ilayh.
Jazakallah khair ustad, barakallahu fiqh. Inshallah we're going to place some of the links below. To some of our other videos and also some of the dua and adhkar. We will link you to a good website where you can find these, download them, print them off, put them around your house. Maybe you can say them and try to memorize them. And like Ustad Abd Rahman recommended, The Fortress of the Muslim is available from most good bookshops, and it's a very, very cheap book, maybe £2 or £3. Keep it with you, it's small, you can put it in your top pocket and carry it around with you. Barakallahu feek for listening. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.